Well, we started out capturing them in the early days, mostly capturing them at night with a snare. Mark Barrow, when he first started out, he figured he'd use a PVC pole. And he got a pretty good size PVC pole, probably an inch in diameter or something, and tightly clamped the snare to that. And he went into the cesspool in Georgetown where they wanted to get rid of a big alligator that was in there. It was a, what do you call it, a sewage disposal area, something like that. And he had one of the game wardens paddling him, and he got this big gator snared, and the gator ran under the boat, and he held on to the pole, and all of a sudden the pole, boom, and he and the gator were both in the cesspool together. And the warden said he got out of that water so fast he hardly got wet. But he decided that he was going to take the clamps off of that thing right then and go to bamboo.
So it's not.
He went to bamboo, which would break. Mm-hmm. We had caught truck biter about, this had been the third time, I think. Well, no, the fourth time. And he had grown to 12, almost 2, I think, wasn't he? 12-2, and he was very angry. And when we let him go, he wouldn't get out of the road. And so I said, let's just go around this way and tail with him, leave him there. And Steve Coker was driving the truck. So he said, no, I can back around him, he won't be in trouble. So when he started to back around him, truck biter grabbed the, that's how he got his name, he grabbed the back fender of the truck and tore it off. And so Steve got excited and started to go in forward again, and I was sitting right here on the tailgate, and I started to fall off on top of the alligator, and Pablo Sorosky, grabbed me by the belt and kept me from falling, and so that was one of my lucky times in my life. I've had a lot of lucky things happen. Sometimes the luck's been bad, but that was one of the good times. One that we call Grover. He was named after Grover Cleveland because he lived in a hole where Grover Cleveland used to have a lodge over here. And right after he was president of the United States, he came down here duck hunting a lot, and he had a lodge. And Grover lived in a little pond there right where the lodge was. So we decided to call him Grover because he was big as hell. He was 12'7". And I remember one time Martin Hudson and I caught him with a trip snare, and we would try to pull him out of the water, just two of us. He weighed 600 pounds, and the two of us probably weighed more like 200 together. Anyway, we pull on him for about 15 minutes until we'd give out, and he would resist, but we would be working him up, you know, slowly. And then as soon as we'd give out, he'd go back in where he was. And we were fighting that damn gator for a little over an hour, trying to get him out of the water. We had a strap around him and everything. We had him, wasn't any question about who was gonna win. I didn't want to put the truck on him because I was afraid that would do too much damage to him. Didn't want to hurt him. And luckily the crew, the South Island crew that worked for Mr. Yawkey came along, or actually they worked for the state by this time. They came along, and there was about probably 12 guys on the truck, you know, 10 or 12. And they all jumped out, and he was on the hill in no time. And one of them was beating his chest because they'd done this so easy. And Grover knocked him over backwards with his tail. They seem to recognize when a food source becomes available that's in high abundance, and they'll head out sometimes for long distances to get there. And not just one gator, sometimes it'll be coming from all directions. There'll be a big food force like a drawdown in an impoundment, which congregates fish in great numbers. And they're very stressed because they're in real shallow water, and alligators can catch and feed on them real quickly and easily. And you'll see, once that situation gets set up, sometimes you'll find 100 gators there. Where the hell did they all come from? How'd they know where to go? And one time we were flying with a helicopter over the marsh when that was going on, and they were coming from every direction. It's like they were communicating in some way or other that I'm not sure how it would have been, unless it was some deep sound or something that I couldn't hear.